Native people. Native culture. Native knowledge. Hi, I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you award-winning Heartbeat Alaska.
Bringing you national and international Native news, this is award-winning Heartbeat Alaska, the premier Native voice in Native programming.
There's a heartbeat loud as thunder. Revolution is in the air. There's a heartbeat deep inside our mother. Are you too cool to care?
Now, with Heartbeat Alaska, here's Jeannie Green.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native News and Native Entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green. Thank you so much for inviting us into your home. If you're a first-time viewer, Heartbeat Alaska is Native News and Native Entertainment from the Native perspective. And we rely on videos sent in from our viewers to share Native events in their area. And we're looking forward to hearing from you. In fact, we heard from Pennsylvania this week and Idaho. Thank you so much for calling and writing. On today's program, we visit Alaska villages as usual and tribes in the lower 48. We begin the Powwow Directory with this program. And Eve Little from Santa Fe, New Mexico, has her report this week. All that plus good Native music. First, here's Gary Fife with Native news across the nation, and I'll be back in just a moment.
This is Native News Across the Nation. I'm Gary Fife. The coming week we'll see a gathering of business leaders for tribes who run high-stakes gaming operations. The United South and Eastern Tribes Gaming Association will convene to bring its members up to date on the latest technologies in the multi-million dollar industry. Organizers say this year's meeting will focus on developing and expanding tribal gaming. They've announced that some of the largest population centers in the southeastern region are near and accessible to tribal gaming operations. They'd like to show members how to take advantage of that. The second annual conference and trade show is taking place in Harrods, Atlantic City in New Jersey. The use of contracts between federal government and the tribal governments has been giving tribes control over the purse strings and hence more control over their lives. Under such contracts, known as 638 contracts, tribes provide their own services that were formerly delivered by the BIA or the Indian Health Service, but the system has been criticized for having its problems. One big one was the law's regulations that were confusing and were not standardized. Now the departments of Interior and Health and Human Services are asking the public to comment on new rules they've developed. For a copy or more information, contact the Indian Health Service Office of Planning, Evaluation, and Legislation in Rockville, Maryland. The deadline is March 25th. On the lands of the Macaw tribe of northwest Washington lies the northwesternmost tip of the United States. Cape Flattery offers spectacular views of rocky ocean shoreline, caves cut out by wave action, and thick forests, but those scenes were not generally taken in by the public. The trail to the spot is in bad shape, but that it may soon be changing, rather. The tribe has won grants from state agencies to begin work on the trail and make it a major tourist attraction. The funding will allow student workers to clear the trail, add boardwalks, and other amenities. The Navajo Nation is working with Northern Arizona University in Flagstaff to teach a course on its tribal culture. The goal is to provide more training and resources on Navajo life to students studying to become teachers on the Navajo Nation and in the area. The current offering, Navajo 405, Navajo Culture and Civilization, will focus on tribal culture and institutions as they've changed through outside influences. The tribal war veterans of the Yakima Nation are building a monument to honor their tribal members lost in this nation's wars, and they're asking for help from the public. The Yakima Warriors Association is asking for sponsors to purchase memorial bricks to complete the base of their veterans' monument. Bricks will bear the sponsors' names or the name of a veteran they wish to honor. For more information, contact the Veterans Affairs Office for the Yakima Nation in Toppenish, Washington. A fire has destroyed the Tribal Commercial Center on the Eklutna Reservation in Wisconsin. The loss is estimated at more than $1 million, but LCO officials say it was more than just money that went up in smoke. Tribal Chairman Alfred Trepania said the fire was a devastating blow, destroying the center of activity on their reservation, and it also costs 40 jobs for tribal members. The complex was covered by insurance, and tribal officials have vowed to rebuild. And finally, Native American colleges got a nice bit of attention and financial support from three internationally known musicians. Singer Carly Simon, along with the talented duo of Daryl Hall and John Oates, performed in concert last month at the Foxwoods Casino in Ledyard, Connecticut. The casino is owned by the Mashantucket Pequot tribe. The musicians appeared to support the River Run Scholarship Fund set up by Carly Simon to benefit the American Indian College Fund. When it was all over, the fund was presented with a check for $20,000. I'd like to say hello to our new viewers on the Outdoor Channel. We hope you like what you see. If you have news or information about your Native group or tribe, please share it with us and put us on your mailing list. For Native News Across the Nation, I'm Gary Fife, and now back to Jeannie Green with more Heartbeat Alaska.
Every day was new love. Our village was filled with smiling faces. The laughing voice of children among the wide and open spaces. The man in the sky, the spirit of our lives and tribal graces. Oh, oh, I want peace with my soul again.
Alaska is in need of reporters and correspondents from across America and across Canada. Here now in Santa Fe, New Mexico, is our southwestern reporter, Eve Little.
It's impossible to miss the latest art creations which graces the walls and galleries at the new Institute of American Indian Arts Museum. Located across the St. Francis Cathedral in downtown Santa Fe.
After all, not many places in this country have contemporary art portraying Native heritage with accuracy and integrity, all devoted to the creativities of Native Americans and Canadians and Alaskan Natives. The new museum here has state-of-the-art conservatories, classrooms, libraries, and more performance galleries. Since it opened in 1992, over 3,000 Native artists have exhibited here.
In collections of painting, sculpture, fashion design, pottery, jewelry, and textile. And of course, not to be missed, is the Ellen Hauser Art Park, named after the most prominent Apache sculptor and former teacher at the Institute. After his retirement, Hauser emerged as top talent in contemporary Indian art, or American contemporary art for that matter. He led the way for numerous indigenous artists until he died in 1992. But his legacy lives on here at the Museum Park, where lectures and concerts are held during the summer.
By exploring these collections, one begins to understand how and why contemporary art has become such an important aspect of communications for the indigenous peoples and their relations to the rest of the world. Therefore, it is not an overstatement to say that the most comprehensive contemporary art exists here at the Institute of American Indian Arts Museum. For Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Eve Little in Santa Fe, New Mexico.
Native news to the world. Join us as we report news from a Native perspective. Heartbeat Alaska is the Native news source for America. We welcome you to be a reporter. Call us today and we'll train you. Join the team.
Hello, welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native news and Native entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green.
This is Native news across the nation. I'm Gary Fife.
Hello, Heartbeat Alaska from way down south, Window Rock, Arizona.
For Heartbeat Alaska and SKC Public TV, this is Annette Brown.
For Heartbeat, I'm Eve Little in Taos, New Mexico. There's a heartbeat loud as thunder.
There's a heartbeat coming up from deep down under.
I'd like to take a moment to pay tribute to a very special woman. She passed away recently. Her name was Laura Wright. Laura Wright was an Alaskan legend. She was part of Alaska history and famous for her parkies.
I hit every target but one, right in the bullseye, and I shot the other bullseye twice and left that one vacant, but I hit it right in the bullseye. So that is the reason I got the 49 out of
Laura 50. Wright was born on October 8, 1908. She was born in Candle, a former gold mining community in northwestern Alaska. Mrs. Wright owned and operated her own business, making parkas for many years.
Hi, my name is Sheila Ezell, and I'm the owner of Laura Wright Alaskan Parkies here.
Her legacy lives on in her Anchorage shop, now owned by her granddaughter, Sheila Ezell. Laura Wright began her parkie business in 1947. After her first husband passed away, she had to make a living, and the parkie business was born, proving Laura Wright was a sharpshooter in more ways than one.
I had to try to shoot at, and then my turn came up, and you had to stand in position, and you had to sit and lie down. There's three different positions that you had to shoot the targets. And I hit every target but one, right in the bullseye, and I shot the other bullseye twice.
In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Laura Wright's funeral is on Monday. Her friends around the world will surely miss her. Our condolences to her family. Let's travel now to Eklutna, Alaska. It's a Native village just north of Anchorage. It's a small village fighting a big institution.
The National Bank of Alaska recently won approval to operate a granite quarry near the village of Eklutna. The Native village of Eklutna is a federally recognized tribe. It's a community 25 miles north of Anchorage. The site of the rock quarry is on one of two hills near their land.
This, here, and here are the knobs or the knolls that will be gone, which are right here. And you've seen those. They will.
Since the arrival of outsiders in the early 1900s, Eklutna people have been pushed off their Aboriginal use area. The villagers are up in arms as the last undisturbed animal migrations route in and out of Eklutna village is being targeted for development.
I own this house here since around 1950, and I'm just about a quarter mile away from the rock quarry, the railroad rock quarry.
National Bank of Alaska is currently the largest operating financial institution in the state of Alaska. Money is their business, with millions of dollars in loans every year. And that's how they acquired this land, through a default on a loan. In 1920, a homesteader received authorization from the BIA Eklutna Industrial School superintendent to homestead the land. But that meant living on the land for 7 years, along with other requirements for homesteading. In 1922, he got an NBA loan. Upon failure of his venture, he turned the keys back to the bank. According to Lee Steffen, CEO of Native Village of Eklutna, the land rightfully should have been returned to the BIA, since the homesteader's requirements were not met.
The title's clear. This land was Native people land first. The BIA superintendent at the time was given the land away, and we're not sure that he had the right to do that.
Yet the bank continues to hold title to 106 acres of land since that date in 1922. Eklutna has been used by Native people in that area for subsistence activities for years, as they do today, where they live, where they bury their dead, where they gather their food. The residents of Eklutna are familiar with being bullied by big government and big business. They haven't given up, though, nor will they give up. They have vowed to protect their small corner of the world. The Native word Eklutna means two hills and a river.
As Native people, if we'd have known in the past 70 some years that this land wasn't properly titled, we would have filed grandfather rights since we've been here first, had we had the opportunity. We're going to take that opportunity now. But in the immediate future, we need to stop this rock quarry. With all people helping, it can be done.
Stand a chance. crazy horse was a mystic. He knew the secret of the trance. And Sitting Bull, a great apostle of the ghost stand.
People think that summertime is powwow season. Well, it's already begun. Let's take a look at powwows across Canada and the lower 48. The music in the background are the Seminole tribe from Florida.
So that they could exercise themselves and show themselves and how strong they are, how brave they are, how courageous they are, and what they can do with their bodies. We're supposed to be in good health, typical good fitness.
We bring Native news to the world. Join us as we report news from a Native perspective. Heartbeat Alaska is the Native news source for America. We welcome you to be a reporter. Call us today and we'll train you. Join the team.
Hello, welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native news and Native entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green.
This is Native news across the nation. I'm Gary Fife.
Hello, Heartbeat Alaska from way down south, Window Rock, Arizona.
For Heartbeat Alaska and SKC Public TV, this is Annette Brown.
For Heartbeat, I'm Eve Little in Taos, New Mexico.
Let's travel now to Beaver, Alaska. It's an Athabascan village on the Yukon River.
Today, Beaver, Alaska is home to mostly Athabascan people. At one time, though, it was the deepest inland permanent settlement of coastal Eskimos. Beaver is located on the north bank of the Yukon River, approximately 60 miles southwest of Fort Yukon and 110 miles north of Fairbanks. It was established in 1906 to develop a rail system in that area of the country. Established first as the Yukon River terminus for miners heading north to the gold fields. In 1911, about the time the gold rush was over, Frank Yasuda, a Japanese who traded at Point Barrow and prospected in the Brooks Range, arrived at the village with a group of Eskimos. Among them were his wife Molly and his adopted son, Turok. Today, the direct descendants of Japanese man Frank Yasuda and his adopted Inupiaq son Turok are gone, but they remain alive in the memories of the people in Beaver, Alaska. Frank Yasuda is said to have walked from Barrow, Alaska, all the way down to Beaver.
I cut sideways.
Flo Gerke and her husband Larry, along with their mother Charlotte Adams, live in Beaver, Alaska year-round. They're familiar with the history and welcome the Japanese tourists that often stop by to visit Frank Yasuda's grave. Flo's son, Matt O'Brien, is building a new home in Beaver, adding to the population of 60 people. Beaver, Alaska, on the Yukon River, a village whose forefathers were Japanese and Inupiat, now is home to Athabascans as well. Frank Yasuda and Turok Newman would be proud.
Hello to my friends in Deering, Alaska. Very nice to hear from you. And nice to hear from you also. Please call. Send letters to Heartbeat Alaska, and most importantly, send video. I'm always looking for news from your neighborhood, your reservation, your community. Share it with those people that watch Heartbeat Alaska, your friends and your neighbors. And while I'm speaking of neighbors, be kind to your neighbor this week. Remember, life is abundant. For Heartbeat Alaska, I'm Jeannie Green, looking forward to visiting you again next week. We'll see you then.
Life was free and easy as we run swiftly, just like the breeze. This is our country. We lived here for many centuries. I want peace with my soul again. Oh, oh, oh. I want my life to be rich again. Every day was new love. Our village was filled with smiling faces. The laughing voice of children among the wide and open spaces. The man in the sky, the spirit of our lives and tribal graces.